I recognize the Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
Mr. Speaker, and thanks to my colleagues for that. I just want to begin with a thank you again to the constituents in Swift Current. I've had the chance to do that already since the election, but I think it's always important that we recognize why we're here and how we got here. So I'm grateful to them for their ongoing confidence and support in working to serve their needs first and foremost as their MLA. I also want to acknowledge the support of my family again, Mr. Speaker, of Tammy and Megan, who's now been in Saskatoon for a bit. But never that far away, as well as Coulter and Faith. Mr. Speaker, I welcome the chance to enter this debate on the speech from the throne. Immediately after the member that's just spoken, the member from Massey Place, who is not only a senior critic, I would say, in the opposition, but also now a leadership candidate for his party. Mr. Speaker, it's interesting that he would get this nod from the leader to be able to deliver what is a fairly important place in the throne speech debate for him to be able to basically close the deal for the amendment that they put forward. I'm not sure if the member for Regina Rosemont, the other leadership candidate that's currently in the caucus, should be worried about what we've seen in the first few days, because, Mr. Speaker, we've seen a decided balance of questions in favour of the member for Massey Place. And the questions they have given to the member for Rosemont have maybe not been the best questions for him. And so, Mr. Speaker, perhaps it's the old NDP way, because the NDP believe in that notion of equalizing from the centre. Maybe they note, Mr. Speaker, that on the websites and the buzz around the New Democratic Party, that it's the member for Regina Rosemont that appears to be in the lead, although it might be the economist, Mr. Weir, who's certainly garnering a lot of attention. But it might be the member for Rosemont based on endorsement. Certainly, if you check the websites, and I know the member for Kindersley has, and you take a look at those who have endorsed the member for Rosemont, there's many, many more of those than those who have endorsed the member for Massey Place, which is interesting, because I think going into the contest, many observers of politics thought, well, you know, maybe the favourite son, the next leader, is the member for Massey Place, and yet it seems that in terms of immediate past colleagues in this legislature, candidates and organizers with the NDP, there is a huge balance in favour of the member for Rosemont than in favour of the member for Massey Place. So maybe that's why he got to speak now, as a bit of a way to equalise things out a little bit. I would like to say, Mr. Speaker, that he did canvass some of the issues in the throne speech, and he made some observations that I think bear some clarification, Mr. Speaker. For example, he talked a little bit about the issue of First Nations engagement in the economy. It's very true that this is central to the growth plan the province has released, that we've released as a government, central to the speech from the throne then by definition, Mr. Speaker. We've seen some progress, some very exciting best practices that are being deployed at the school board level, being deployed by institutions like SIIT that are bearing results for First Nations and Métis as we seek to see them more engaged in the economy. This must be our first priority in dealing with what is the second component of our growth plan, and that's the plan around the labour shortage. Yes, we need more immigrants. Yes, we need more people, more expatriates to come home. We need more other Canadians to come back. But first and foremost, we must deal with the fact that Aboriginal unemployment is much higher than non-Aboriginal unemployment, and here is a great opportunity for us to deal with a labour shortage and fully engage fellow citizens in this province to a greater extent. We've heard from the NDP, if not from the member that just spoke, though, Mr. Speaker. I think the NDP said in a press release that First Nations unemployment, this was just the other day, that First Nations unemployment is at an all-time high, the highest it's ever been. Mr. Speaker, that's not true. The highest that the First Nations unemployment has ever been was March 2006, 29%, and those members were in office. Mr. Speaker, those members were in office, and they presided over an economy that, to say the least, underperformed. The surest way to see First Nations not fully engaged in this economy is to not have an economy that's creating jobs in the first place. And this is the record of that government. This is the record of that party. The member who just spoke also talked a little bit about immigration. We've also seen him ask some questions of the minister here. Well, immigration also features prominently in the growth plan. Mr. Speaker, we've identified the need for the cap on immigrant nominees to improve from 4,000 to 6,000. We need the federal government to help in this regard. We've identified the need for us to continue on the job fairs, Mr. Speaker, to keep going to markets where there are skilled laborers who can build their future here in the province, who can help deal with the labor shortage. But it's interesting, you see, Mr. Speaker, that the NDP have this newfound interest in immigration. It's newfound because the record would say something completely different. When that member stands up, and that member from Massey Place wants to talk about immigration numbers in this province and changes the federal government has made and what we are doing to react to them, he ought to remember that between 2001 and 2006, they were in office, his party was in office, there was a total of 8,000 newcomers to the province under immigration initiatives. Since 2007, under this government, with focused and decidedly more ambitious goals, with a better relationship with the federal government, the numbers increased from 8,000 under his party to 39,000 under the Saskatchewan. So, Mr. Speaker, it's interesting to hear the member from Massey Place now espouse on behalf of his party this great interest in seeing Saskatchewan welcome more immigrants and improve settlement services. Never in the history of this province, well, save perhaps for our first 10 or 15 years, have there been greater numbers of new citizens to this country choosing Saskatchewan, and never in the history of the province has there been the record investment in settlement services to welcome these new Canadians to our province and to, Mr. Speaker, ensure that they are fully benefiting from life here in the province of Saskatchewan.
Right on. These are the facts.
Mr. Speaker, in terms of the member that just spoke, his fellow candidates, including Mr. Weir, who's an economist, says, and perhaps a front runner, has looked at the members, just proposed. Some of his proposals in his leadership campaign. The member for Massey Place has made a number of proposals, policy proposals. For example, he has called for the modernization of Hansard, Mr. Speaker, and more camera angles in the legislature, I understand. Now, Mr. Speaker, I think that he's onto something, because if there's one thing that I hear in the coffee shops of Swift Current and around this province is people saying, if there was only a modernized Hansard in this province, if only there were more camera angles so we could look at the MLAs while they speak to us like we're doing right now today.
Which angle do you prefer?
But Mr. Speaker, to be fair to the member for Massey Place, there's been a broader policy proposals on other issues. Mr. Weir, his counterpart, the front runner, says that his proposals are fine, but added, the fundamental problem is not the party's policy-making process, because that's what he's focused on, process. He says, Mr. Weir says, the problem is that our elected leadership has not paid attention to party policy, Mr. Speaker. I don't know if that's true or not true. That's for New Democrats to decide, but it's interesting that these are some of the comments we see with respect to the member who just spoke and engaged, as he should, in the speech from the throne. Mr. Speaker, as the member engaged in his throne speech and others have in this assembly, some have talked in different shades of enthusiasm about growth in the province. I think you would note, Mr. Speaker, to be fair, and I try to follow as many as I could, I think you would note that when members on this side of the House talk about growth, not taking credit for the growth, the government didn't cause those things to happen. Hopefully we're getting out of the way of that growth. Hopefully we're dealing with its challenges. That's what the speech from the throne is all about. But when members on this side of the House talk about growth, there is a greater degree of enthusiasm about it, Mr. Speaker. And I'm not sure why that is, except to conclude that the New Democratic Party have really never really been comfortable with a growing Saskatchewan. In fact, I remember a day not long ago when pundits and others would posit for political discourse in this province the theory, the notion that those members opposite were actually more comfortable when people left this province, when our population was either shrinking or stagnating because they thought their political interests would be served by the status quo. They had been in office for so long. They had an economic development minister when confronted with Mr. Laudermilk, when confronted with out-migration, said, don't worry, when people leave, there's more left for the rest of us. So, Mr. Speaker, this is what underlies, I think, some of the discomfort that we see from members opposite about growth. They're sort of paying this notional homage to growth now. And the member that just spoke, and others across the way that have just spoke on the speech from the throne, including the member from Athabasca, if he's spoken in the debate, he has. When they have dealt with the speech from the throne, and the plan for growth, Mr. Speaker, they seem to be They seem to be uncomfortable just stating that growth is a good thing up front, that this is what we ought to be doing in this legislature, facilitating that growth, meeting its challenges so that it can continue. And if we needed more proof of that particular view, and that is my view, we only need to look to the words of the Leader of the Opposition. When the growth plan was announced in Saskatoon, a number of media went to the Leader of the Opposition, the Leader of the New Democratic Party, to ask him what he thought about the plan for growth. And in the provincial media, what I'm about to read, I don't think I saw it covered, but it was covered in the Globe and Mail, so he must have also done an interview with the Globe and Mail, Canada's national newspaper. Here's what he said about the plan for growth. This is the Leader of the NDP. He said, a document like this distracts everybody, and I think his, brackets, Wall's popularity will stay up there as long as there's sort of a myth of a booming economy.
It's a bad attitude.
The Leader of the New Democratic Party characterized what's going on in this province in terms of the growth that we see as a myth. 80,000 new people coming to this province in 5 years is a myth, Mr. Speaker, according to the NDP. This province leading the country in economic statistic after statistic, retail sales, Mr. Speaker, building permits, new housing starts, we lead in all those, but for the NDP, this has just been a myth. For those in this province in small business and those who are now working in better paying jobs, all of this that we've seen in Saskatchewan over the last 5 or 6 years is just a myth. Mr. Speaker, we see average weekly earnings moving up in this province. They have consistently moved up in the last 4 or 5 years. Mr. Speaker, at a percentage that we haven't seen in Saskatchewan, especially, not just including, but especially under members opposite when they are in government. They know that because we just heard them at least pay sort of notional or tacit homage to this growth that's going on in the province. That's what they're saying in the speeches, because I think they believe, well, we kind of have to say that now because people in Saskatchewan kind of think that things are pretty good. So I guess we kind of have to sort of go along with that. But we'll switch quickly to redistribution. We'll switch quickly to our old ways, Mr. Speaker, which weren't about growth, but about, Mr. Speaker, the status quo and a stagnant economy. And the proof is in the fact that the leader of their party calls what's going on in Saskatchewan today a myth. So we have a choice, Mr. Speaker, when it comes to New Democrat politicians and New Democrat parties at various levels. You can choose the federal NDP leader. He doesn't describe our economy as a myth. He describes it as a disease, Mr. Speaker. You can have him, or you can have the current NDP that sit in this legislature. In the midst of the growth that we've seen in this province, they call it a myth. Mr. Speaker, I would suggest to them that notwithstanding what they were trying to admit, I think, in some of their speeches from in the throne speech debate, until they understand the fact that this place has changed for the better, not because of this particular government, but because of growth that's happening, that we're more diverse because 39,000 newcomers have come to this province in 4 years, that more people are working in Saskatchewan than ever before, until they realize that this is a different place, rural and urban, north and south, they're going to be a small group sitting to your left hand, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, it's interesting. The debate has been about the economy, and it should, because the speech from the throne is about that as well. Lately there's been some discourse, even amongst those NDP leadership candidates, about economic policies here and what they may be doing to the national currency, Mr. Speaker. We have had the federal leader of the New Democratic Party. He has depicted our economy, our resource-based economy, as a disease. And so we have wondered, quite rightly, we have wondered as a party and as a government and as colleagues in the legislature, when one of them sitting over there, certainly the two that are running to be the leader and maybe one day premier, when one of them would stand up for Saskatchewan and say, you know what, our federal leader has it wrong. We sort of think Mark Carney might have it right. We sort of might think the facts might have it right, even as we've seen manufacturing numbers move up in this province and across the country with resource development. Because remember what Dutch disease says. Dutch disease is the principle, the economic principle founded in the experience of Holland, where resource development spiked the currency and currency hurt exports and that hurt manufacturing. Well, Mr. Speaker, that we've certainly seen resource development in this province. We've seen it in potash and uranium and in oil. We've seen it in any number of other minerals. Frankly, more interest in all of that. We've seen it in the rest of Western Canada. But this has been good for Canada. Yeah.
This has not just helped the West, this has actually fueled manufacturing jobs to replace the ones that were lost in the recession, Mr. Speaker, not just a few years ago in that province. That's what this province is doing for the rest of Canada. And so you would think that one of them that's running for the leadership of their party, that aspires to be the premier of this province, would stand up and say, our leader is wrong on this. Not one of them has. In fact, one of the leadership candidates has gone on to say, no, the federal NDP are right. There is Dutch disease here, and what we need to do is increase the taxes on the resource sector. Close loopholes, he said. Close loopholes, he says, increase the taxes on the resource sector, and that will dry up the overheated investment, I think is his notion, his theory. And that happening in Saskatchewan will change the Canadian dollar, Mr. Speaker. So not only have we had neither of these two leadership candidates who sit in this assembly on a regular basis say that Mr. Mulcair is wrong and stand up for the province, we have actually their NDP leadership candidate saying that they agree with him. Mr. Speaker, this is a very important point. They may not think it is, but people in this province, regardless of party stripe, especially when it comes to natural resources, we saw it with potash not too long ago, they want their elected representatives, their government, or anybody in this assembly who is elected, they want them to stand up for Saskatchewan's interests. And these leadership candidates have failed the very first and important test in this regard. We take a different view on the government side. We take a different view, and it's represented in the plan for growth that underpins the speech from the throne. We take a view that growth is good, that the resource sector is good, that exports increasing by triple in the last 10 years is good. We've set a goal that now that they would double. We see agriculture as the strength that it is, Mr. Speaker, in this growth plan. I've been very interested to see some of the commentary from those who observe politics in our economy about the amount of time this growth plan, which underpins the speech from the throne, dedicates to agriculture. For a long, long season in this province, governments, New Democratic governments, didn't want to talk about agriculture. More than that, there seemed to be a willingness to sort of let that rural component of this province, that crucially important rural component, sort of just survive on its own. We'll close 50 hospitals, we'll rip up farm support programs, we'll get by because there's more seats in the city than there is in the country. And it wasn't just a political calculation that was unfortunate and tragic for this province, Mr. Speaker. It was an economic miscalculation. Because anyone could have seen then, although agriculture wasn't as strong as it is now, anyone could see then that the world's population was growing. The UN's been reporting for some time about what's going to happen in terms of worldwide hunger. Economists around the world have been reporting, Mr. Speaker, that as there's greater and greater members of the middle class in India and in China and in places like Indonesia, 240 million people growing at 7%, the middle class wants greater and greater amounts of protein in their diet. Guess what? That's good news for this province. It's good news for a province that's 44% of all the arable acres in the country. It's good news for a province that's responsible for 58% of the world's exports of lentils and 55% of the world's exports of peas. It's good news for a province that now is 47% of China's canola seed imports and 37% of China's canola oil imports. It's good news for a province that now constitutes 50% of the imports from Indonesia. So this plan for growth recognizes that growth is good, that we need to sustain it, that export development is good, and yes, that we have to deal with the challenges that come with growth. By the way, let me state for the record again, we believe on this side that the challenges of growth are much preferred, much preferred by people in this province than the challenges of decline that we saw. Mr. Speaker, as more and more people leave this province, as more investment flee this province in the years previous, our economy, our economic base, our tax base just atrophied and got smaller and smaller. And so the governments of the day had less money to invest in arts and culture, less money to invest in healthcare, less money to invest in education. Why? Because, Mr. Speaker, theirs was not a growth imperative. We've already ran over their history. We had a Minister of Finance, I think Mr. Malinchuk, maybe it was when he was Minister of Education, who quite proudly and tabled in this legislature a plan for decline in the enrollment system. Just going to happen in Saskatoon, never mind in the rural areas. Mr. Speaker, this is the mindset that informed the members opposite then, and I dare say now. based on what we've heard in their speeches. Mr. Speaker, this plan for growth recognizes that there are challenges that we will meet, and we will meet them together. It recognizes that in the last 4 years, there's been a 63% increase in investment in public infrastructure when you consider federal, municipal, and provincial infrastructure investments, but that's not enough. So we have to do more. And it highlights $2.5 billion worth of infrastructure we have to do. It highlights $30 million to partner with Cameco's $30 million to rebuild Highway 914 in the north. It recognizes the need for a municipal infrastructure program, for a new vehicle to deliver infrastructure called SASC Builds. It recognizes the need to pursue P3s. It recognizes the need to provide capital SASC Builds. So we've taken $150 million from the Growth and Security Fund to do that, leaving $500 million in the fund, Mr. Speaker, in the rainy day fund. It recognizes that we have to deal with the labour shortage. It lays out ways and plans to do that because we've been listening to stakeholders and people in the province. Mr. Speaker, make no mistake, we understand on this side of the House that there's a lot of work to be done, that while the government ought not to take credit for any growth, and doesn't, that the government needs to be prepared and proactive in facilitating that growth, in providing the right business climate, a competitive climate with competitive corporate business tax rates, but that we also need to facilitate that growth by being prepared for the infrastructure challenge that lies ahead. That's what's at the heart of this document. That's what's at the heart of the plan. And what this plan also recognizes, Mr. Speaker, is that the point of all of this, the point of a plan to continue the growth, at least for government to facilitate that kind of growth, and then to deal with the infrastructure challenges, the point of all of that isn't growth in and of itself. It's the dividends that we find from growth. It's the investments we can make to reduce surgical wait times. It's the investments we can make in our classrooms. 50% of the schools in this province have been renovated since this party took office. And there is more work to be done. There is new schools being built. We understand that the dividends of growth allow us to eliminate that wait list of those who have disabilities who are waiting for the dignity of a home, of a group home space. That was spoken to earlier in member statements. Mr. Speaker, we were surprised to hear ministers report to a cabinet just a few years ago that under this government, the Social Democratic government, who do a lot of talking about those who are most vulnerable, that under their government, the wait list for people who had disabilities for a place to live and for respite programming was over 450 people. And so because the economy was growing, we had about $40 million that we could take as a government, say, here's a four-year plan to eliminate that particular wait list. Mr. Speaker, when I got elected to this side of the House in 07, the wait list in the Swift Current area through Southwest Homes for these, our most vulnerable, was 25. Mr. Speaker, not very long ago, that wait list was zero. A lot of families moved to Swift Current, which is great. So I think we might have one or two on the wait list, and we'll deal with those, Mr. Speaker. But we won't be able to eliminate that wait list across the province if we follow the dogma and the ideology of that party, which is to pay lip service to growth, but to pursue policies like a $200 million tax hike on small business, the engine of the economy. We will not be able to achieve those goals if we follow their plan. We have seen it in this province. We've been through it in this province. Now we understand what growth can provide. It can provide for a better quality of life in this province. It will perpetuate what we're calling the Saskatchewan Advantage. There'll be cycles that we'll have to deal with. That's why we're going to have an ongoing rainy day fund. But Mr. Speaker, we know that in a world that wants energy security and food security, our chances are great so long as we pursue these policies represented in the speech from the throne, and so long as we remember why we want growth in the first place, Mr. Speaker, and for these reasons, I will be opposing the amendment, and I'll support the main motion.